And up next, we have How to Be a Strong Applicant for Occupational Therapy by Ms. Rosa Alvarado. So give her a hand, everybody.
Thanks, everybody. Good afternoon. I think we're all sleepy. So let's try this again. Good afternoon. So once again, my name is Rosa Alvarado, and I'm actually an admissions counselor at Samuel Merritt University. And I work primarily not only with the occupational therapy program, but also with our nursing programs as well. But today we're going to talk about probably one of the coolest careers that I've encountered in my very, very long history of working in higher education, and that's occupational therapy. Just very quick survey, raise of hands. How many of you have heard of Samuel Merritt University? Okay. How many of you have heard that there was this wonderful, awesome, super rockin' profession called occupational therapy before today? Okay. So not to put anyone on the spot, does anybody want to kind of give it a go in terms of defining what occupational therapy is or what they think it might be? So safe zone, there's no right or wrong answers, but anybody want to give it a stab? Who are my brave souls? Yeah, go ahead. Okay, so it's a type of therapy that works with people related to their everyday function. Okay, anyone else want to give it a go? No? Consensus, we're all happy with that definition? Or are we all just kind of shy? Do we do the group hug now or later? Just kidding. You're right. I think occupational therapy does center on helping someone regain, work with them in terms of their day-to-day context. I think in the simplest terms is the key word that comes up to me when I think about occupational therapy as a profession is adaptability, okay? And adaptability not just in terms of helping a patient or a client adapt to their situation and helping them regain back to their daily living activities, kind of what's meaningful to them and what kind of helps define who they are in the context of their identity and their relation to society and whatnot, but also adaptability for you as a practitioner. The profession really is very, very malleable. And what I mean by that is that there is not one fixed type of work environment that you will find an occupational therapist in. You will find them in hospitals. You will find them in the nonprofit or community sector. They work in schools. They work in private practice. They work in corporate sectors, working as consultants. If you enjoy developing a new product and helping others make something work, occupational therapists definitely engage in that type of work as well. What I like to lovingly refer to as the MacGyvers of the rehab professions, because occupational therapy, a portion of that profession really centers on being able to create an adaptive or assistant device. So you give an OT student or an OT practitioner a stick of gum and some duct tape, they will create something amazing that will impact people in very substantial ways. But when we really think about kind of more of a clinical or a formalized definition of what occupational therapy is, it really is an evidence-based practice. It is rooted in the sciences. But beyond that, it really does work with people in terms of really helping someone get to finding that meaning of what life is, which if you think about it, we're all kind of trying to answer that for ourselves in different ways anyways. But the role of the OT really does engage in that type of meaningful work in a variety of different examples. So what does an OT do? Or does, rather. Sorry, it's been a long afternoon. OTs engage in a variety of different things. One of the very first things when you think about occupational therapy is that they work in a customizable treatment plan. In other words, it really is a very individualistic driven treatment approach that the practitioner engages in. It's assessing the patient, it's assessing the client, and really helping them identify where they are in relation to what they can or cannot do for whatever the issue is. And then developing a treatment plan that takes them either at the next level or the next stage of development, or in some cases, when we think about the role of occupational therapy, especially in the area of dementia care, for example, it's retaining those cognitive abilities as long as possible, right? In addition to that, as I said before, they work in a variety of different settings. And the second bullet point really kind of talks a little bit about some of the things that you'll find an OT engage in a corporate or a private practice endeavor, really looking at evaluating an environment and really creating recommendations regarding adapting. One of the other things that I actually really do like about occupational therapy is that you do not practice in a bubble, meaning that although at the root of the relationship or the practice is you and your relationship with your clients or your patient, as an OT, you have the ability to really kind of take a more holistic approach. So understanding that our interactions with life, our interactions of finding meaning, really is centered with who we are in relation to others. So as an OT, it's taking into account things like cultural nuances. If you're working, if you're working with a community that's different from your own, striving to understand how occupational therapy or the treatment that you're developing with your client really impacts their cultural lens. What other support systems are in place to help them? So it really is a very robust, very holistic profession, and it is something that you actively engage in as a practitioner. In terms of the status of the profession nationally, if you've done a little bit of research, you should know that occupational therapy is one of the fastest growing professions in health. There is a high demand for occupational therapists nationally. And again, I think a lot of it has to do with the adaptability factor of you as a practitioner, being able to serve multiple roles in a variety of different settings. But looking in terms of emerging populations that occupational therapists engage in, we have an aging population, and there's definitely, with that growing number of our segment of the population that is now seeking for additional support as they age, that's opening up a wealth of opportunities for someone like an occupational therapist because they engage in a variety of different things. The statistic that you see at the bottom in terms of the average salary being $83,000 actually is a little bit outdated. I believe the statistic is from 2011, so it's actually gone up. Now, fair warning, OT is not for the faint of heart, nor should you be going into this profession or any profession in health simply for the money. It really is centered on your passion and your desire and how well something like OT fits with your worldview in relation to wanting to help others, okay? So a little bit about Samuel Merritt, just for a quick little side note. Samuel Merritt University, we're a very unique institution in that we're a health sciences university. We've been around over 100 years. We started off primarily as a hospital-based nursing program. And in the mid-90s, we expanded to include other programs, occupational therapy being one. But the picture that I'm showing to you, I'm showing for multiple reasons. One, because it's a great way to showcase our students and them in action. But it's another way to kind of see the variety that of the type of work and clinical practice that they engage in. You see kind of more of the traditional kind of clinical-based or kind of hospital-based stuff at the top part of the screen where you see that student taping the arm of one of the patients. They definitely engage in very complementary work when you think about comparing occupational therapy to physical therapy. So in a lot of ways, they execute very similar things to engaging more on the things that I talked about earlier, and that's the day-to-day life activities. So the bottom pictures at the bottom is really kind of showcasing a little bit about our Living Skills Lab. If you go onto our campus, you walk into the Living Skill area of our campus, and it basically looks like someone's house. And so a lot of the treatment is centered on how do we live, and how do we, for example, cook if, say, for example, the left side of my body is paralyzed. So that, and this is also a really good example of some of the hands-on practice experience that you'll get under our program. As two-year students in our program, you actually engage in three student-run clinics, one being an adult clinic, which is what we're seeing here. There is a pediatric clinic, and then there's a mental health clinic. This is all done in preparation for the actual practice of your fieldwork experience, which is required as part of our degree. So, as I said before, quick facts about OT, at least at Samuel Merritt. It was established in 1994. It requires four semesters of didactic work, essentially 2 years, and one semester of a level one field work, which takes place at the end of your first year, and then a six-month level two field work, which will take place starting in the summer of your second year and will run all the way until mid-fall. So that's where that half year comes into play. Any questions so far? No? Okay. In general, our curriculum is a total of 79 units. We seek to admit 37 to 38 students each fall, so we only admit once a year. There is a part-time option that is available. However, it's not a very fixed curriculum. Rather, it's something that's done in conjunction with consultation of our department chair. So from an applicant perspective, you essentially are applying into our program. And once you're admitted and you decide you want to hang out with us for a little bit for your degree, it's then at that point that you have the option to choose to go part-time if you feel the need. Our pass rate in 2003 for the national boards was at 98% first attempt. As I said before, we have three clinics within the curriculum. Two of them are actually on-site, specifically the adults and the pediatric, and the mental health is actually conducted within the local community near the university. One of the other things that I think makes our curriculum kind of interesting is that we incorporate a lot of simulation-based learning. And simulation-based learning, if you know a little bit about that, is something that really has heavily been promoted within the nursing programs. But what it looks like for occupational therapy is essentially having paid actors that come in, clinical actors that come in, and will essentially create a scenario based on the direction of the faculty member. If you visit us and you visit our Sim Center, it can read something as simple as walking into a room that looks like a patient room in a hospital. And the actor is in there with their presenting issue. The student is given a very fixed scenario and kind of mock patient record, so they kind of have a sense of what's going on. And there's cameras in this room. And then in another room, further down the hallway, is the rest of the class watching them. As well as the faculty who is hiding behind a mirrored glass who is actually directing the actor. So as exciting and possibly terrifying as that may be, we do that purposefully. We do that to create more confidence in your emerging skill set as an OT. And the best part is that we do this before you even hit a field work placement. So a lot of the scenarios that you will find that you go through under our program are things that you will see as in your field one and definitely in your field work two placements. So we do that for a reason, because simulation-based learning allows you to learn in a safe environment with no right or wrong, but really, really zero in on your growing development as a practitioner. This is just a photo of our pediatric clinic, which in true confession is probably my favorite clinic on campus. 9 times out of 10, it's usually taking place in the fall. And for the last couple of years, it's had an opportunity to take place around Halloween, which I don't know about you, but that's kind of one of my favorite holidays. So it's always fun to go down there and witness those sessions taking place. And you see our OT students dressed up like witches and pumpkins, and someone once dressed up like Buddy the Elf. And it's just kind of a really interesting thing to watch, because it definitely feels like play, but there's very much an underlying purpose in terms of how they're engaging these kids. So just a little bit more show and tell in terms of some of the work that our students do. Now, getting into the nitty gritty of occupational therapy at Samuel Merritt, how do I get in? In terms of our admissions requirements, they're pretty straightforward. The first is you have to have a bachelor's degree, or you will need to have earned it by the time you start our program. We also are going to be looking for a minimum of 40 to 70 hours of observational or volunteer experience in an OT setting. That's the minimum. To be competitive for us, typically applicants that are successfully admitted hover closer to the 100-hour range. The observational experience does not need to be fixed with any one particular group or one particular setting, but rather it really is what I like to call kind of create your own adventure. We are genuinely interested in knowing what your experience has been to learn about this profession and how you incorporate your experiences within an OT setting to support your general answer to that big question that I think all OT programs ask of you, and that's why. Why do you want to be an OT? In addition to the hours, we're going to be looking for three letters of recommendation at the minimum. You can definitely submit more than three. But from the three, at least one must come from an occupational therapist that is currently practicing. The second should come from an academic source. And the third is your choice. So it can be another OT, it could be a pastor, it could be an employer, everyone except maybe your grandma or your mom. But again, it's really thinking critically in terms of identifying those recommenders who know you, either in the context as a student or someone who is an emerging practitioner or a prospective OT student. So being mindful of that is going to be important as you prepare your applications. Now, as I said before, three is a minimum. You can submit more than that. Remember, the key is quality, please, not quantity. Submitting 10 letters of recommendation will not guarantee admission into our program. So really, be thoughtful and be purposeful in terms of the overall impression that you are seeking to give, not just us at Samuel Merritt, but I would argue any occupational therapy program or really any graduate program in general. In addition to the admissions requirements, one of the other things that we also do is we're going to be looking whether or not the applicant has completed the prerequisite courses, and we'll get to that in a couple of moments. But I want to talk briefly about the GPA calculation, because there is a lot of variance among OT programs in terms of how the GPA is calculated. The first thing is, at least here at Samuel Merritt, we generate one GPA that we refer to as a cumulative. However, it's not a true cumulative in the sense that it is everything that you've ever done. Rather, this cumulative GPA is based off of your last 60 semester units or your last 90 quarter units or a combination of both. So what does that mean? Does anybody have an idea what that means? No? Essentially, what that means is we are roughly looking at your last 2 years of college level coursework. Now, that includes anything that you may have taken after earning your bachelor's degree. So, for example, if Harry Potter, after graduating Hogwarts University, realizes that he has missing prerequisites and decides to enroll in his local community college, when we calculate his GPA, we will look at his coursework at that community college in addition to what he may have completed towards the end of his time at Hogwarts. So in the simplest way to kind of understand how we calculate that, we start with the most recent term that you have a final grade for, and we're going to count backwards until we reach 60 semester units or 90 quarter units. Now for us, it's not just all. We really look at coursework that's at a C minus or higher. So if you've gotten a D or an F or you withdrew, those are examples of coursework that would not be included in our GPA calculation for that particular GPA. The second is a science GPA. Science GPA is a little bit different. With that, we pull every science course you've completed, whether you took it as a in your first year as an undergrad or you took it last semester or last quarter. For us, science is very fixedly defined as coursework that comes from the traditional sciences. So by that, I mean coursework in chemistry, in physics, in biology, anatomy, physiology. physics, things of that nature. Those kind of specialized or hybrid kind of science courses, such as biological anthropology or biomechanics coming out of a kinesiology department, or geology or natural science, are coursework that typically will not be included in our GPA calculation. Okay? So the minimum for the two is a 3.0. Statistically speaking, in terms of what the averages look like for the GPA based on the last 60, it is hovering closer to a 3.6, 3.7. Science is averaging about a 3.4, 3.5. Any questions so far on that? Yes. We do not require the GRE. So for those of you who are actively seeking programs that will not be looking at the GRE, you may have found one with us. And that's done purposefully. We actually, our faculty did engage in actually looking at the correlation between performance on the GRE and ultimate performance during the first year of our program. And they found that it wasn't a strong enough predictive factor, so they did away with it. So I don't know about you, but I was pretty excited about that, even though I myself am not applying, but I thought that was really good news to see that. In terms of actual prerequisite coursework that we're going to be looking for, we're going to be looking for two English courses, even though we list them as composition and critical thinking. As a general rule, any two English classes or any two writing classes that you have to fulfill to earn your undergraduate degree typically are acceptable in meeting those requirements. In addition, we're going to be looking for at least one class in general psychology, a class in abnormal psychology, a class in developmental psychology, a class in stats, and two social science electives. Social science electives can be filled from a variety of different disciplines. So it can be additional psych classes, sociology, ethnic studies, women's studies. Things from that particular realm are usually appropriate. We also require a class in a three-dimensional skill or craft. So a three-dimensional skill or craft, we know, is a little bit unique. There are not too many occupational therapy programs that require this. For us, it's very meaningful to us. If you remember what I said earlier, that OTs engage in kind of the MacGyver work of creating adaptive devices, this is your opportunity to demonstrate that you have that ability to kind of think outside the box. So what do we mean by a three-dimensional skill? In basic terms, it's, do you have the ability to take a raw material and manipulate it into something else, okay? So appropriate examples of things like that would be a class, say, in ceramics or sculpture, sewing, woodworking, jewelry making, things along that nature. Examples of coursework that would not be used or cannot be used to fulfill this requirement would include what I refer to as the fine arts, so dance, photography, painting, that cannot be used to meet those requirements. Yoga is not a three-dimensional skill class. Soccer playing is not a three-dimensional skill class. Weight training is not a three-dimensional skill craft. Besides taking a class in a 3D course, you also have the option to submit a portfolio. So if you have a hobby or you do something on the side for your own enjoyment that kind of fits that definition of a three-dimensional skill, you have the option instead to submit a portfolio to showcase that. Besides that, we're going to be looking for at least one class. We're going to be looking for a class in biology, as well as a class either in a basic or introductory physics course. So conceptual will be fine. We're not looking for the high-level Stephen Hawking's hypothetical or theoretical physicist Sheldon Cooper type classes, but really a conceptual physics class that covers mechanics is more than sufficient. Any questions so far on these prerequisites? Okay. Lastly, there are three courses that we highly recommend. They're not technically required for admission into our program. However, I would argue two out of the three, it is strongly to your benefit to have it, not just in terms of being competitive within our applicant pool, but also thinking ahead in terms of being prepared for the first year of our program, and that would be the human biology and anatomy. The third, which is the public speaking, again, not having the public speaking class, that in and of itself will not be a deal breaker for us, but it's definitely recommended if public speaking is not your thing. Guaranteed within 2 weeks of your first term with us, you will be speaking in front of your class talking about something at one point. So if that's not really your thing or your forte, I would encourage you to consider taking a public speaking course. Okay? The application deadline is we subscribe to OTCAS, so the deadline to submit the application is October 1st of the year prior of enrollment. So for example, those who were seeking admission for fall 2015, the deadline for us was October 1st of this year. Okay? Questions so far? Okay. So fall 2014 data, this is a brief snapshot of what our applicant pool looked like. We received a little over 300 applications. It was a sneak peek. No. Again, we sought 2 seats, so we enrolled 38 students. The average GPA was a 3.6 for the last 60, last 90, and the science was a 3.4. Any questions so far? So, yes.
So you're accepting your application in October 1. Is all the coursework done by then? Or are we still doing coursework and we're going to update you with better transcripts?
Great question. You can definitely apply with coursework in progress or planned at the time of application. However, my advice to students is always make sure that your GPA especially can stand on its own without those courses missing, okay? Or pending, rather. Because when we do the GPA calculation, it's one time and one time only. If not, to be very honest, we would never be able to admit anyone because we would be updating everybody's GPA all the time. So if you decide to apply with classes pending, that's great. Just make sure that your GPA can stand without the help of those classes. And then the other bit of advice I'd give with that is make sure that at least the biology and the physics are completed when you apply, because that definitely looks a little stronger to the selection committee as opposed to having those pending or in progress. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So one of the things that I was asked to talk about was how do you prepare a really awesome application, right? One of the first things I will tell you, having a 4.0 since kindergarten is super awesome, but it's not required for admission into not just our program, but I would argue any program. I think at the core, the first step that I think all of you should be aware of when you think about applying to any program is your ultimate goal is to become an occupational therapist, yes. But the very, very first thing that you are actually doing is you are applying to graduate school. And graduate school is a totally different type of admissions process than what we all went through when we first got into college. It is highly individualized. So what does that mean? It means that collectively, we are all looking at your maturity. We are all looking at your critical thinking abilities. And you demonstrate that by answering that big why question, which is really, why do you want to be an occupational therapist? Or, you know, why do you want to be an underwater basket weaver? And it's your ability to be able to clearly articulate that answer that ultimately going to determine how far you get within the admissions process. I think the first factor is that personal statement. That personal statement is your very, very first introduction that we will have of you. And so being able to have your personal statement be thoughtful and clear and incorporates essentially everything that you've done to bring you to this decision of submitting the application will be critical to your success, okay? I say this all the time to students. A GPA, really the only thing a GPA tells us is whether or not you can handle our learning environment, okay? It tells me if you're a good student. What it will not tell me is if you have, for lack of a better description, the internal good stuff to be a really, really good OT. Your personal statement is what will tell us that. The little bit of advice I can tell you about the personal statement is that collectively in my history working in admissions is I've seen applicants that tend to be successfully admitted, their personal statement kind of share three very common factors or a very generalized outline. The very, very first thing is what I refer to as your defining moment. And defining moment, at least for us, is not just occupational therapy is a good idea and let me pursue this. But we're interested in having you take us to that one moment where it stopped being, hey, this might be something I want to do, to 100% I cannot imagine doing anything other than occupational therapy. Okay? When did that light bulb turn on for you? Take us at that initial moment and then move into what I call the second phase, and that's your journey. So that's where your observational hours should be kind of giving you that source material. What were those things that resonated with you that when you left, you know, for the day, you were still thinking about? Or was it a particular reading, or was it a particular conversation or something that you observed? What were all those little moments of this is really cool, or hey, this is, I'm on the right track, that this is the right career? Those are the things that we would like to see built in within your personal statement. And then kind of wrapping it up is your future thinking. Take me to the future. And what I mean by that is when you close your eyes and you imagine yourself working as an occupational therapist, what does that look like? Is it with a particular population? Is it working in a particular treatment modality? Is it in a particular work environment? What are you dreaming of? That's what we want to know. I think one of the common mistakes that we see in admission when it comes to the personal statement that really kind of feels like missed opportunities is really reading those personal statements that are very broad and generalized, okay? Things like, I don't know, it was a cold, snowy day when I was born, and I knew then that I was going to impact the world by serving as an occupational therapist. First of all, I'm really impressed that you have that level of self-awareness as a newborn. But it doesn't give me much other than you're a really, really great writer with really, really great ability to create a really dynamic scene. But I want you to get deeper than that. And that is what I think the biggest piece of advice I can give you all, regardless of whatever it is you pursue. But when you're talking about graduate school, we want to know who you are, because that's really going to determine more than anything else whether or not you're going to be a good fit for us, okay? Does that make sense? Are there any questions? Yes?
So what kind of question applicants do in the process if they apply the first year and don't get in? Are there chances less in the following year?
Great question. So what happens if I apply and I'm not admitted? At least at Samuel Merritt, one of the things that we do work really hard, and I know I work really hard especially, is we make ourselves available to the applicants once decisions are out. Those that have been waitlisted and especially those that have been denied. And we will sit down and work with you and talk about what went right and maybe what are the things that maybe you need to work on, okay? In terms of chances, it's always kind of a very nebulous question to answer, because the reality is we have no idea who you're going to be competing against when you apply from one year to the next. But I will be honest that in a case where you are reapplying from one year to the next, what our committee and what we collectively are going to be looking for is your growth. What did you do different? In some instances, my experience has shown that a student who is not successfully admitted the first time sometimes apply before they're really ready. Whether they have too many prerequisites missing, their personal statement is still, they're still trying to figure it out and answer the question for themselves, and it shows. Or if they get to the stage of the admissions interview, nerves gets the best of them, or whatever the case may be. But again, that's where I think my role as a counselor really is to kind of help serve you. As much as I'd love to invite all of you to join the OT program at Samuel Merritt and offer you all admissions, the reality is I can't do that. But I can definitely serve as a resource for you to kind of help you understand the way admissions works. But ultimately, your job as an applicant is to get us excited about who you are, okay? And I keep hitting the personal statement because it really does play an important role. The personal statement, like I said, really is your first introduction. It's kind of like, the best analogy I can give you is, you know when you go to the movies? And you get there early and you're checking out the movie previews, right? And you're like, do I want to see Harry Potter? As you can tell, I'm a big Harry Potter fan. Do I want to see Harry Potter? Do I want to see Batman? Do I want to see Godzilla? Your personal statement is your movie preview. So throw in your special effects. Throw in the Brad Pitt or George Clooney or, well, maybe that's my thing, but or whoever you guys think is really cool. Your personal statement should get us excited about who you are. So that we're standing in line and we're buying the popcorn to watch the midnight showing of your movie, which basically translates into us inviting you to an admissions interview, okay? So I can't stress enough how important that personal statement is, because it really does give us a sense of who you are and gives us the first taste of what type of person you are and what type of potential you have for this profession. Any other questions? No? Have I effectively traumatized all of you? No. Okay. All right. Well, if you have additional questions, I'll be around, but I definitely want to thank all of you for your time and spending time with me. If you're interested in learning more about Samuel Merritt University, you're definitely welcome to give us a call. My contact information is listed up there. Oh, before I do forget, one of the things that we do are prerequisite transcript evaluations. So you're definitely welcome to email me your unofficial transcripts, and we will take a look at them and give you a sense of where you are in terms of meeting the prerequisites, as well as we will generate an unofficial GPA calculation for you. So you'll have a very clear understanding of where you are in relation to you know, what we typically say. Okay? So thank you again for your time. I hope you found this information helpful, and, you know, good luck to all of you in your endeavor, and I hope I see some of you all cross my desk via your application soon. So have a good afternoon, everybody.